Disney gives folktale cool makeover in Frozen. Los Angeles, IFP Disney has given a chilly makeover to a traditional fairy tale in its latest animated release, Frozen, which could be in the running for an Oscar. The movie is based on Hans Christian Andersen's The Snow Queen 25 years after Disney's last Andersen adaptation. The Little Mermaid, even if it takes substantial burdens with plot and characters, the studio's 53rd feature-length film, which has had positive reviews ahead of its release for the Thanksgiving holiday in the U.S., bring to fruition a project which was on Walt Disney's wish list, although he never made it. Walt Disney was passionate about trying to do a version of this. The films of cult producer Chris Buck told at a press conference to present the films at Disney's Burbank, California studios before its release Wednesday. Feral Core producer Jennifer Lee added, "Unfortunately, we dug for some original manual, but nothing really surfaced. But we knew that this was special for him." Although the exact reason Disney himself did not make a film of the 1844 Andersen tells Lee, who co-wrote 2012's Oscar-nominated Wreck-It Ralph, said she was not surprised. "It's a very hard story. It's very symbolic. The Snow Queen herself is not clear drawn," she told the reporters. The makers of Frozen expect to make the animated feature shortlist for next year's Academy Awards in March, got round the difficulties by making substantial changes. The two main female roles, the Snow Queen herself and Gul'dan, have been transformed into sister princess Elsa and Anna. Elsa, who transforms everything she touches into ice, flees her kingdom after mistakenly condemns it to an eternal frozen winter. Her sisters go searching for her, added by Rugged, mountain man Kristoff, and a snowman. There are a couple of very powerful elements, like this little girl who has nothing but the power of love and who fights the negativity, said Lee. Fear is a big thing in our society, so the idea of the little Anna, who's an ordinary person who just has the gigantic heart trying to go up against the power of fear to fight her way through and save her kingdom and save her sister at the same time. He was so rich. Elsa is voiced by actress Idina Menzel, who told AFP the main thing was to maintain a vulnerability. Then no matter how powerful she is, there is a sadness and a loneliness to the character. In the beginning, she was written more like a traditional villain, and then, when they started working on it, they changed her and made her a much more complicated character and not a villain at all. Just someone that was misunderstood, she added. Visually, the widescreen cinema scope film is stunning, and the animators travel to Norway to gain knowledge and inspiration to render the snow surrounded and the ice encrusted landscape as if to order. Large swath of the U.S. were gripped by a major winter storm this week, leaving tens of millions of Americans facing travel charges as they head off for Thanksgiving family reunions. Musically, it fits into the Disney tradition of snowstorm songs, with a score by Robert Lopez, who wrote hit musical comedies, The Books of Mormon and The Armenian Q. Frozen has a 90% positive audience rating on the Rotten Tomatoes movie review website, which describe it as beautifully animated, smartly written, and struck by a sing-along song. Frozen is preceded by a short Get a Horse by Lauren McLemore, which combines pastiches of black and white Mickey's and Minnie's sketched by before plunging into 3D virtuosity. Crucial jobs clean up after Philippine typhoon. Tacloban, Philippines, AFP, tens of thousands of desperately needed jobs are being created for survivors of a catastrophic typhoon in the Philippines by paying them to clear mountains of waste from ruined cities and farms. UN agencies are spearheading the Cash for Work programs, which they hope will provide a triple boost to communities destroyed by Super Typhoon Haiyan, with lifting morals as vital as cleaning up and helping economics. This is not only important to help normalize the economy, but working gives a sense of dignity back in their lives, said Tim Walsh, leader of the United Nations Development Program, UNDP, team deployed by the worst-hit city of Tacloban and the nearby areas. The United Nations, working in partnership with the Philippines government, is hoping to create at least 200,000 jobs that could last for up to 3 years. Walsh said their immediate task was to help clear the mountains of rotting garbage and debris, which is necessary to allow for faster transport of aid and the delivery of other essential services. As much of the material as possible will then be recycled. Haiyan, the most powerful typhoon ever recorded to have hit land, slashed across mostly poor central islands of the Philippines region, killing more than 5,500 people and destroyed or damaged the homes of 4 million. Giant storm surges generated by the typhoon were more destructive than the winds, powering more than 1.6 miles island on the island of Latin and the Samar. Thousands of coastal community were obliterated as the water crushed homes, fishing boats, vehicles, electrical, post, and virtually every other pieces of urban infrastructure. Vast stretch of coastal rice farms were also contaminated, and their irrigation channels destroyed. While the wind tore down millions of coconut trees, they were a main state of the already extremely poor islands. Lisa White, a spokeswoman for the UNDP team in Tacloban, said the Cash for Work program was similar to an effort in Indonesia's Aceh regions as one of the world's most devastating tsunamis killed 170,000 people there in 2004. Some of the things we are seeing there are comparable to action, include the consistency of the debris, like the wood, the metal, rock, and the concrete, aside from the organic waste and the bodies still being extracted every day, she said. The volunteer works are being paid between 250 and 500 pesos, $5 to $10 a day, to haul the debris to select collection points, which trucks pick them up to be taken to a temporary landfill outside the city for sorting. The wood and the timber we can refurbish, which we did in Aceh, where we used them to rebuild schools and houses, while the concrete we use for roads, Wright said. We reuse as much material as we could. The UN's Food and Agriculture Organization is looking to set up a similar cash for work program in agricultural areas, paying farmers and others in the community to clean their land and desolate irrigation canals. It said its programs will cover more than 150,000 hectares, 370,000 acres, and 80 kilometers, 50 miles of communal irrigation canal that need to be cleaned, warning upcoming harvests are at dire risk without quick action. However, the FAO needs more money to get the program into top gear, and this week launched an international appeal for $11 billion. John Lim, the Tacloban city administrator, saying having people help in the cleaning and the rebuilding process was an important way for them to deal with the trauma of the disaster. We want to give them a sense of direction, to try and get them back on their feet by giving them an incentive in helping us clean the community, Lim said. And for works such as Rowena Kaunda, a mother of five, there is indeed relief that they no longer have to depend solely on aid to survive, as well as a touch of pride. We are doing decent work and we are helping the community, Kayuda said as she pulled at a rusted metal sheet roof in Tacloban. Kayuda said she and her mechanic husband, who lost his job after the auto shop he worked for was destroyed, had initially thought of abandoning the city, but they didn't have any money to travel. Now that we have a little, we think we can start a small business, maybe a store, and not live at all. Kayuda said. Orphans in Philippines speak of typhoons hollows. Tacloban, Philippines AP, the teenager with unruly hair in a ponytail wipes tears from her eyes as she holds her feverish 3-year-old brother, who clings to her and lets out a sob of his own now and then. They have been inseparable ever since they lost their parents to Typhoon Haiyan's tsunami-like storm surge. The water was so strong, also the wind and the rain. 15-year-old Shirlini Teresi Negro said, "Our house was cut into two. She and her 3 surviving brothers, ages 3, 6, and 12, are among an unknown number of children in the eastern Philippines who lost their parents to the massive November storm, ruffling Chondra," a spokeswoman for UNICEF said the agency is helping to rapidly trace the families of affected children and to connect them with relatives. The death toll from Haiyan, one of the strongest typhoons on record, has risen to 5,560 with 1,757 others missing, officials said Thursday. The United Nations said at least 40 million people have been affected, including 1.8 billion displaced children. The storm almost completely flattened the seaside neighborhood whose Shirini's family lived in Tacloban, a coastal city devastated by the typhoon. She and her brothers now live with her mother's aunt in Barangu, a farming town about 14 kilometers from Tacloban. Friends gave them the clothes they now wear. It doesn't matter if we lose everything, as long as we can have our parents here, said Shinili, a high school student who dreamed of becoming an accountant or a journalist. She accepted that her parents are dead. She only wished to find their bodies, and the body of the brother who died not survive. Selini said he climbed to the ceiling of the family two-story home when the water suddenly rose. She and her brothers clutched walls and anything they could hold onto. The last time I looked, my mother was just beside me, but when I looked again, she was gone. She sobbed. Her 12-year-old brother, Richard Chris Negro, held on their brother's hand, but she could not move because her leg was pinned under debris. He said she told him to hold on his younger brother, to take care of her siblings, and to be a good boy. Then she let go and was swallowed by the rising water. The children's father was able to carry the 2 younger boys to the ceiling, but he too disappeared in the water soon after. Richard Chris took the 2 boys and they managed to reach a neighbor's rooftop. Selene tried to save her 10-year-old brother, Richard Lawrence Dunchon, who was mentally disabled. She held him, but struggled as the water rose, and when she was hit by a deep breeze, he lost his grip. I thought I would not survive because I really did not know how to swim, and I was already feeling weak, she said. She grabbed a neighbor by his shirt, and he helped her reach higher ground. She found her other brother in the neighbor's rooftop. Rachel Lawrence's body was found in the stair of the neighbor's house later that day. Rescuers placed his body by the roadside with other corpses. The siblings, grandfather Ricardo Negro Jr. left him there overnight to look for Selene's cousin. When he returned, the body has been collected. More than 2 weeks later, the family is still searching. The grandfather said the boy was likely buried in one of the city men's graves, but he didn't know where. Negro, a far 70 years old, now lives in a church that has been turned into a shelter and spent his day trying to find Rachel Lawrence's body, along with those of his son-in-law and his daughter, his only child. With tears welling his eyes, he said he only wanted to give them a decent burial beside his wife's grave. Negro's sister Rosie Aguilar has taken in his orphan grandchildren, a retired teacher with two grown children. She said she was close to their mother and will raise them as her own. The children carry green memories. Richard Chris, the 12 years old, vividly recalls seeing the body of his younger brother in a neighbor's staircase. He has blood in her eyes. In his eyes, he said. When asked how he's doing, he simply marvels, "I'm okay." Dying Chicago woman weds partner in first Illinois gay marriage. Chicago Reuters. A Chicago woman who is dying of cancer wed her partner on Wednesday in the first legal gay marriage to be celebrated in Illinois, 6 months before the state law recognizing gay union takes effect. The cancer patient, Vernita Grave, 64, and Patricia Edward, 65, were wed in a private ceremony in their Chicago home 2 days after they were granted an emergency marriage license in federal court. According to a legal group that advocates for gay rights, Illinois gay marriage law, signed by Gov. Pat Quinn last week, does not take effect until June 1st, 2014. The couple has sued, arguing the delay discriminated against them by preventing the couple from marrying before Grace Day. I'm so excited for us and for the community. For today is beginning, one so richly deserved, said Gray in a statement. Illinois last week became the sixth state to recognize same-sex marriages. This was the latest in a series of gay rights victories, as Hawaii earlier in the month approved gay marriage and New Jersey Governor Chris Christie in October dropped his appeal of a court ruling that legalized same-sex rupture. This story has been referred to correct spelling of lament in second paragraph. Editing by Bob Bergdorfer. Germany's new minimum wage raises hopes for earlier life. Frankfurt AFP security guide Holger Schäfer hopes the introduction of a fixed minimum wage under Germany's new coalition government will make his life a tiny bit easier. The tall 51 years old with closely cropped hair once ran his own security firm with 36 employees, but for the past 7 years he has been scraping by, earning just 7.71 euros, $10.5 an hour as a guide with a major security firm in Frankfurt. It is difficult to get by, Schaeffler said, without a hint of self-pity. By working 60 hours a week and 240 hours a month, he takes home barely more than 1,800 euros, and he is just one of 5.6 million people who earn less than the hourly 8.50 euros that will be Germany's fixed minimum wage. It was part of a deal hammered out overnight by Chancellor Angela Merkel's conservative and the Social Democratic SPD to form a new left-right grand coalition government. Boss of his own firm until 2001. He used to allow himself a monthly wage of 5,000 Deutsche Mark, or what would be around 2,500 euros today. But those days proved short-lived, thanks to cutthroat competition in the sector and a falling out with a former business partner. I found myself bankrupt with 200,000 euros of debt, the father of three said. The money and work troubles cost him his marriage. He was on the door for 18 months doing odd jobs here and there, during which he sold off more than 100 job applications. I was overqualified, he fumed. Finally, he got a job at his current firm, beginning at 7.23 euros per hour. I wanted to get back into work as soon as possible. The pay was less than I did hope, but I took it, because there are people out there who work for even less, he said. Minimum wage won't survive everything. His wage has gone up only fractionally since then. After paying his debt, he rents for a tiny two-room flat and other costs. He has just 5,000 euros a month to feed and clothe himself. I can only shop in a discount supermarket. I never go to a cinema or on holiday. I don't have any money to set aside, and I'm not allowed to run up an overdraft. On top of that, I have to support my new girlfriend and pay off my daughter's schooling, he explained.